Thank you. I am delighted to be here. And I appreciate that very warm introduction. And every time I am introduced and I listen, I'm always saying to myself, who are they talking about? I don't recognize her at all, but I am always humbled to be reminded how God has used me, but also I am embarrassed to be the first of anything, because no one grows up wanting to be the first. You just want to do God's will. It is culture that makes you first. It is obstacles and it is systems and it's powers that make you the first, but you just want to do God's will. So I am grateful to be here. I certainly want to honor our bishops in this great meeting. Sorry that I did not get to meet Bishop Curry, but he did send his regards. But I appreciate Bishop Bruno and this committee and this group for this important opportunity. Certainly, living in Nashville, Tennessee, on the other side of the whole world, I was not quite sure of the relationship, the geographic relationship that is, between Ontario and San Bernardino. But in the world of Google Maps, I was able to Google Map just where I was going vis-a-vis the tragedies of this week. And then to be on the van, the shuttle van last night from hell, mind you. The 3.5 hours or so it took to get from the LA airport to here because of traffic and the driver and craziness. And just as I was about to complain, to look up on the expressway, the sign saying San Bernardino, certainly I paused and came to myself and said, whatever misery I am feeling right now on this van does not compare. And so let me keep my mouth shut. But I am here and I am humbled and I am trembling at how close I am to the senseless tragedy, murders of this past week. And I am sure that once I get back on the plane and certainly start journaling about this moment in history to have been brought here. And I say to myself, I wondered to myself on the way here, I wonder how even this gathering might have been different if what happened this week had not happened. Would it have been business as usual? Would our conversation have been different? And certainly how our conversation has no doubt changed, whatever was on the agenda, whatever the speakers were going to speak about. Because people often write you and ask you, what are you going to speak about? And they ask you that months ahead. And certainly anyone coming into this area this week, like myself, certainly found herself pausing to say, God, what do we say at moments like this? So it helps, and to some degree, to be a Bible scholar, but in particular, an Old Testament or Hebrew Bible scholar. And I began by talking a little bit about that journey as an African-American girl who grew up in the 50s and 60s, who made her way from Atlanta, Georgia, to Wellesley College, then down from Wellesley College to New York City, where I was a broker with Merrill Lynch. Well, actually, before Merrill Lynch, I worked for what was Coopers & Lybrand, a public accounting firm for about a year there in Boston after graduating. Then moving from there to Merrill Lynch to New York City, and then over from Merrill Lynch to Princeton. And there at Princeton, receiving a Master's of Divinity and falling into a PhD, if you will, in Hebrew Bible and Old Testament, and then ultimately down to Vanderbilt to teach as a Bible professor. But that journey, those journeys are not linear by any means at all. That they are helter-skelter, they are stumbling, they are knocking into doors, they are knocking into yourself as well. They are, as Kierkegaard says, life is lived going forward, but it's only understood by looking back. And it is at the moment you are making a decision based on chance and opportunity and invitation and flesh and love and heartbreak and money and various kinds of things. But it is only as you look back you begin to see the hand of God, that there was overall the God that was orchestrating some things. And so my journey into becoming a Bible scholar, certainly in times like this, I appreciate it, because I could have certainly become an ethics professor or pastoral care, church history, and a number of those others. But it was like so many of us, God calls us through great mentors, and certainly God uses great mentors. And so my mentor at the time was Bernhard Anderson, who was the author of Understanding the Old Testament, and he was a professor at Princeton at the time that I was there. And to be a young African-American woman from the black church tradition there at Princeton in the early 80s, that was around that time, and not quite sure why I was there. I mean, I had a vague sense of calling and all of that, but to find myself there at Princeton under the tutelage of Dr. Bernhard Anderson, the author of Understanding the Old Testament and a number of other books, but a biblical theologian par excellence, and to watch him walk across the stage of Old Testament, OT01, the introductory survey course in Old Testament, and watch him walk across the stage without book, without paper, without notes, and talk about God bringing Israel from a struggle, through a struggle, to a struggle. And this was back when dinosaurs roamed the earth. And so this is back when there was chalkboard and all he would have, and I'm almost gesturing as I say it, because he would always have a piece of chalk right there in his finger as he's walking and as he's gesturing. And he would say how God brought Israel, the story of the Old Testament, the story of the Hebrew Bible, the story of the Torah, is the story of God, how God brought a people from a struggle, through a struggle, and to a struggle. And by all means, as an African-American young woman who grew up in Atlanta, Georgia, and just on the cusp of the Black Power movement, but certainly the dawning of the women's movement of the 70s in terms of coming to my own consciousness and when I cut my own teeth, and to hear him talking about suffering, and to read Von Rod and others, and Eisfeld and others, and listening and thinking about suffering. For me, the Old Testament was the natural choice, both because I had a fine professor, but also because of the laments, also because of the questions of Job and the questions of how do we make sense of, and God, where were you, and God, how could you, and God, what is happening, and God, how long, and all of those kinds of things. It became a natural decision for me, I think. It felt natural at the time. Now, looking back, you look back and you perhaps see the hand of God moving on your behalf. And so now, as I think back to that period and I look back over my life now, I am I'm aware of a deliberateness, a divine deliberateness, a divine mindfulness, if you will, working a kind of meaning out of a kind of very broken life at the time. And so today, to be able to stand to talk a little bit, and just for some moments, I want to kind of put my finger on that journey, certainly as and because I am at that age now, certainly, and I can look out over this room and see that I share in a particular generation of us, and those of us who've got more years behind us than we have ahead of us. And those of us certainly, and even no matter how much we may dye our hair, we are not as young as our joints. Our joints tell the truth. The knees and the elbows and the neck tell the truth, even in spite of what the hair color may say. That we are winding up a generation. And so as I look over those kinds of things, I'm looking at and I'm interested, because the next book that I am certainly supposed to be writing about is about this whole notion of change and transition and where we're going and where have we been. More importantly, where does it look like we're going, as though I know any of that. But this notion of change and transition and revolution and the notion of the radical newness to which God is calling us, this seeing through a glass darkly, this preaching as though you have a sermon until the sermon comes. I believe it was Flannery O'Connor who says, every morning I get up and I go downstairs and I sit in front of the typewriter, having no idea what I will write. But I sit there ritually and habitually and faithfully every morning, she said, just in case something comes. And certainly those of us who are ministers, who are clergy, we know that experience. We mount the pulpit, not always having a full sermon, not knowing the beginning, certainly not knowing the middle, and praying to God for an ending. But we stand there faithfully, Sabbath after Sabbath. We mount that pulpit just in case God has something that God wants to say through us. We do not stand because we know what we are to say. We know what we have prepared, but we do not know what we are to say. We know what we have typed, but we do not know what we are to say. We know what we prepare, but we don't really know what we are to say. But we prepare to be faithful. We prepare because we've been trained to be prepared. We prepare just so that we can show God that we take this moment seriously. But just in case God wants to tear up the notes, just in case God wants to turn off the iPad, we are saying, God, I'm available. Just in case you want to speak through these old clay lips of ours. And so that notion that things are changing. So even now, as I turn to the few notes that I do have on my iPad, and I often have to say to people, I am a Flintstone pretending to be a Jetson, but I'm really a Flintstone. So it may turn off, I might flip it, and it may go somewhere else, and I might be clicking right here, and you just stay with me, I'm going somewhere. But I know, I admit now I'm a Flintstone, but I'm pretending to be a Jetson here, because I don't want the world to leave me. I want to catch up to where things are going. The Bible describes a world when people still believed, and that is certainly what attracted me to biblical studies. People who believed, and people who even believed in believing. Believed that there was a God, believed that God spoke, and that when God spoke, God used intermediaries to speak through, and people sought out these intermediaries for clarity, for comfort, and for confirmation. Certainly my own study of the prophets, that is what my dissertation was on. The Hebrew prophets, sexual metaphors, metaphors of violence and rape in the prophetic books of Jeremiah, Ezekiel, and Isaiah. Prophets. I'm a Southern girl, Protestant girl, who grew up in a Protestant church where there were revivals. This was back when revivals were for at least a week. Maybe 2 weeks if you were from very Southern Pentecostal roots like mine were. And we believed in prophets. Oh, education kills something. Because when you go away to college and you get a PhD and you discover that perhaps the prophets who came through your church were not prophets after all, but they were prophets to a 13-year-old girl who had this indescribable curiosity about God, who never wanted to go to the children's church for children's Bible study, who never really wanted, was never interested in youth church, but always wanted to be right there in the midst of the grown people's Bible study and there listening to Deacon Foxworth and Elder Briley argue over how could Jonah stay in the whale for three whole days and exactly how many Johns are there in the Bible after all. And I mean, these were deep questions back then, and these things split churches, you know. These are the things that tear churches up. And I was this young, eager 13-year-old who was very fascinated with these. And prophets, I believed. I grew up with revivals, and I grew up that believing that prophets were real and that some people had a special gift and that they could see into your heart. And they were called to come and speak a word. It was not enough to be a great preacher. Anybody could be a great preacher. But a prophet always finished the sermon with signs and wonders. It was not enough to preach. You had to foretell. You had to lay hands. You had to call someone out. You had to see into the future. In my tradition of the Pentecostal church of growing up, Black Pentecostalism of the South. And so the prophets would come, and we believe that they had a special anointing, that God allowed them to perceive, well, what's on the mind of a 13-year-old, but her private lust. Prophets were able to see your darkest secrets. And I tell you the truth, prophets were always calling me to the front. Always calling me to. Now, of course, back then, you know, like I said, education kills something. And back then, I believe because the prophet could see my heart. Now, I think it was because I had the biggest afro in the church. I stood out as a girl with an afro in a very conservative church. But the prophets were always calling me to the front. Young girl, you know God wants to use you. Yes. Do you know that God's hand is on you? No. But God has great things in store for you. Are you going to allow God to use you? Yes. Now lift your hands and repeat after me. That was the ritual for my life throughout my high school. And so I grew up believing that prophets could see into your heart. It took going away to college. It took becoming a graduate student, earning a PhD, to cause me to question the prophets of my Pentecostal origins. Question whether they were real prophets, true prophets. Question whether or not God was really using them or whether there's really some fakery going on there. Question whether or not, but one of the things I could not question was that they were right on one thing, and that is that God is always moving, calling, beckoning, inviting, and God is always present. Whether they could see into my future and could they say that I was going to become a clergywoman, I doubt that they ever imagined that. that I would go on to get a PhD in Old Testament. I know that that was it was unimaginable to me, and I know it was unimaginable to any of us in 1970 there in Atlanta, Georgia, at Vine Street Church, Jones Avenue Church of God in Christ on Vine Street there in Atlanta, Georgia. But nevertheless, that sense that there is a God who sits high and looks low, as the old black slaves would say, that God sits high and looks low. They were right about that, even if they were not right about the particulars. But this sense that they believe that God was in the midst, and so the prophet, the priest, the seer, I would learn about as I would go on to become a graduate student. But fundamentally in all of that, this notion of undeniable belief that God is with us and that God is present. I just, again, pretending to be a Jetson, I tweeted the other day saying that I do not believe that God is going to spare us of mass shootings. I believe that God is going to leave that to us to take care of. The writer of Deuteronomy says, the secret things belong to God, but the things that are revealed, they are ours to do, to know, to understand, and to take care of. They are the secret things, but the things that are revealed, the injustice, the hatred, the oppression, the wars, the rumors of wars, the greed, those are ours to wrap our hand. Do I believe that God can be with us? Absolutely. But there is much work, and I believe that that is part of our agenda here. After all of the voting, after all the passing of resolutions, after all of the Robert's Rules of Order, after all the talk about budget, there is a moment at which this meeting ought to, and I'm sure you have already, so I am not here trying to indict anyone, but after all of those other things that we have to do, the church business, we also have to stop and say, now God, in the providence of your all-seeing eye, your knowing that we would be here just 25 miles away, we need a word from you, oh God. We need to hear from you. If we don't hear from you, what will we do? It was the prophet. Yes, he was a prophet, but he was also a Jewish theologian, Abraham Heschel, who says that a prophet knows what time it is. Do you know what time it is? In each prophetic book of the Old Testament, except for a few, most often they are introduced with what we call the superscription, the first few verses of the prophetic book. The prophet Jeremiah, who preached under Zedekiah and Jehoiakim and Jehoiakim and Josiah, they are superscriptions that give you some idea of the time, the historical context, the Zitzim Laban, the world in which the prophet, that prophecy, that preachers, that meetings like this, that faith, that religion, that our convention, that our church does not just happen. It just didn't just fall out of the sky, but it is shaped by the history, the context in which we find ourselves, and our religion, our worship, our work of this church does not just fall out of the sky, but it is in response unto the times. Do you know what time it is right now here in California? It is certainly a time of uncertainty. It is a time of uncertainty. And for someone like me who grew up, my ordination is in the African Methodist Episcopal Church. I was raised in the Pentecostal Church. I went to a Presbyterian seminary. I married a Baptist who used to be Catholic. He said because he wanted to have a conjugal, he wanted to conjugate. So he left the Catholic Church, did not want to become a priest. He did not know that you really could. But nevertheless, the point here is that I've had all of these journeys. My ordination is in the African Methodist Episcopal Church, but my background is the Pentecostal church. But one of the things I miss in that whole notion of the Pentecostalism is that there is this sense of the imminence of one's relationship with God. I missed in my kind of Methodist Episcopal high church tradition now of is that sense that you must know the moment, the hour of your conversion. That was a before Christ and an after Christ moment. We call it the mourner's bench. We call it tarrying. But education kills something. And so I look back on that now with an anthropologist's eye and as well as a scholar's eye, and I poo-poo that. And that is what the undereducated, the uneducated, the Pentecostals, the non-degree people believe in that, but the Methodist Episcopal, we are not confined by time. It is universal, the universal truth, the universal God. But I miss that notion that there are some moments in time when we ought to know that we know that we know. Amen. There is a God. Amen. There are those moments when we ought to be able to say, now that just had to be God. Those moments of conversion, those moments of change, those moments in my own life when I sense that God has been moving, but yet I grew up in a tradition that believed in certainty, and yet there's no more. At 61 years old, it just feels like there's no more certainty, that everything is in a fluctuation, that everything has changed. Nothing stays the same. The young becomes the old. But everything must change. And so, how do we be the church? The church that is built on certitude. Religion that is built on the God who is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. A church that believes in tradition, 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 tradition. The church that believes in heritage, 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 heritage. And how do you be that church that believes in tradition and heritage and certitude in a time of flux? A time of transition, a time of uncertainty, and a crisis of faith. What does it mean? Do we barrel down and say that we are not going to change? Or could God be in the change? Could it be that it is on our watch, as, and I'm paraphrasing the late Phyllis Tickle, could it be that we are in the midst of a new reformation? That on our watch, there is a new era, a new epoch, a cleaning out of the attic, Phyllis said, a kind of rummage sale that's going on in the church right now, where everything is up for redefinition and reorganization and rethinking, that our shrinking budgets and our shrinking attendance and our fears of where the church is going and what's going to happen to the church, and not just what is the future of the church, but does the future have a church in it? Certitude. Could it be that God, not just culture, but that God is up to something? Mm-hmm. That God is cleansing the church. That God is streamlining. that God is right-sizing, that God, behold, I do a new thing in the earth. Right now, while I am here in California, it is 10 minutes to 2, as opposed to 10 minutes to 12, there in Nashville. And right about now, after 6 weeks of my being, I'm one of the co-pastors at my church with my husband. At least I say I'm co-pastor when I don't like what's going on and I want to change some things. Otherwise, he's the pastor. But when I'm mad, I'm the co-pastor. For the last 6 weeks, I have been teaching the church on using the book, Our Iceberg is Melting. I strongly recommend that book to you. It is a fable. It's written as a fable, but fables have deceptive power. It presents as a children's book in large print and colorful illustrations. A six-year-old could read it in about 45 minutes. But it's the story of an emperor penguin colony faced with potentially devastating problems that is threatening their home. And from a management point of view, it is, what problem? I don't see a problem. It is a good book. And so, for the last 6 weeks, I have been using this book, part of our leadership at our church, and using the chapters of this children's book to talk to our congregation there in downtown Nashville, to let them understand that our iceberg is melting. Our membership is down, our offerings are down, our enthusiasm is down, the neighborhood has changed, it has been gentrified and rezoned. And right about now, the other pastor, the one who gets this task because I get to go to California, gets to tell the people that we are selling the church. I'm in California. I left it to the other pastor to tell them that we must change, that we must follow the cloud, the pillar of cloud, and the pillar of fire, because we must change or die. We must move or be swallowed up. We must relocate or be irrelevant. I know personally about the change that we're all going through. Our iceberg is indeed melting. I, who was raised, like so many of us, with the belief in the certitude that I could stand in the ocean and cause the waters to part, that I, who believed in the power of prayer and speaking in tongues, believed that you could speak to the situation and that the situation could be changed. I still believe that, but I also believe that superseding that is the hand of God and is the move of God. And if I want, and if our church, our little tiny church, whose the ocean is so big and our little boat is so small, and while we can sit there and just pray like the people in Hurricane Katrina, we could just pray and say, God, just keep the hurricane from coming. Or we could just begin to build a boat. Or we could just begin to learn how to swim. Or we can just begin to realize that we cannot, there is some change we cannot change. And so we must now move a congregation that is tied to a particular area and help them to unmoor from that area and see that the church is us and it is not a building. that the church is the people and it is not a geographical location. You can put your hands together because I know I'm not just talking to my about my situation. And so I leave you with two stories that I want to share here. As a Bible scholar, I have been asked to write a book, and a book about change. And there are two characters in particular that I ask you to let me share some concluding comments about. And I've been studying them quite a bit, and I've written about them on a blog in one place, and the book is coming out in another year or so. But I've been reading a lot, and I've been very fascinated with the story of Reuben there in the book of Genesis. And I would have to say also Mary Magdalene, who's not mentioned but ought to be mentioned in another book there in the New Testament. Reuben, because many years ago, and his name has already been mentioned here, Reuben, because many years ago I heard a great sermon about the Reuben option. And it made me think, in the midst of change, the son, S-O-N, who saw his brother as a threat to his own security. And Reuben is indeed, I think, an archetype of the brother who, you know the story, I won't go through the full exegesis of the story. He is the one who, he doesn't talk, when the other brothers want to kill Joseph, Reuben doesn't want to kill him, but he don't want to help him either. He says, let's not kill him, let's just throw him into a pit. Let's not kill him. Let's just go back and tell daddy that a beast came and destroyed him. But let's not kill him. Reuben is the one who he won't help you, but he won't hurt you, but he won't help you either. Reuben is the one who stands there and sees change coming. Knows that Joseph represents the future. Joseph is arrogant, he's obnoxious, he preens and he peacocks. He's naive and he's foolish, and he's a tattletale. But time will fix all of that. But for now, his sheaves are standing. And Reuben and his brothers hate that, hate the change on the horizon. And Reuben is the brother who'd rather die than see change come. I am amazed as a college administrator and as a co-pastor, I am amazed at the people who would rather see the church die than change. I'm amazed at the people who do not want to see the success of the next pastor. I am amazed at the people who are entrenched in yesteryear, how we've always done it. That's not the way we do it. Here is how we do it. I'm amazed at people's absolute resistance to change. I know how frightening change is. And Reuben, poor Reuben, he is that side of all of us. And I say this because there is some Reuben in me. As radical as I may be known and as much as I may want to speak truth to power, I am now 61 years old and there's more years behind me than in front of me. And certainly I who grew up in a church there, in another church there in Cambridge, Massachusetts, and I was a part of the young people of the church, and how this pastor was just so Afrocentric and so much into young people because he was young. And I remember the fight with the older people of the church. I remember how the older people resented that we wanted drums and we wanted loud noise and we wanted to dance and we wanted to sing and we wanted to sing Oh Happy Day, and how that was just not what the church wanted to hear. They wanted to hear their anthems, and we wanted to rock with Andre Crouch, and we wanted to sing with Edwin Hawkins, and we wanted something lively. We did not want the Clara Ward music. We didn't want James Clean's music. We didn't want Mahalia Jackson's music. But now I'm 61, and now I come to church, and sometimes I say, "Ooh, Lord, it's just so loud in here. Ooh, Jesus, it don't take all that." Could it be that it was all so simple then? Or has time rewritten every line? And if we had the chance to do it all again, the way we were. I am now old. People call, good-looking men call me ma'am. I don't want to be a ma'am. Don't refer to me as mother. I'm not your mother. I didn't ask you to hold that door. I can open the door. So I understand Reuben. And I must speak to the Reuben in me at church when I hear the young people, and we have a young assistant minister who gets up and preaches in that kind of rap sound. And I don't know what he just said. But I must stand there and clap as though I heard it. So just in case God speaks. Just in case. I clap just in case, because I know that everybody is looking at me, at the 61-year-old, and I want it to be said that I want to move forward with God, that while none of this makes sense to me, while I do not understand a thing that boy just said, but I believe that God speaks even through hip-hop. And so Reuben is the brother in all of us, the apathetic Reuben in all of us, the side of us that don't want to quite let go of the positions that we have held for so long because our identity is so wrapped up in it. Reuben, the one who I may not heard it, but I didn't help the new president of the auxiliary. Reuben, the one who throws a rock and then hides his hand. Reuben, the one who prefers secret ballots because he's too coward to stand up and say, "This is what I believe." Reuben, who doesn't really want to see the church change, even if God is a part of the change. Reuben. And every day, I must speak to the Reuben in me, the one that prefers to hear the music of my youth over the music of my daughter's youth. Even though my generation is moving off the scene and my daughter's generation is completely unmoved by my music. Who was it that tweeted the other day? But I thank God he apologized. But he did tweet. What is the big deal about this black The Wiz? If we white people wanted to have a white Wiz, there would be an uproar. What a fool he was.
Amen.
What is the Wizard of Oz if it was not white? And yet he begrudged black people, black young people, the excitement over the Black Wiz because he did not know history. I'm grateful to God he did come back on and apologize to say that he was wrong. He did not know his history. So the point I'm making here is that notion that we can be wrong. And are we willing to stand up and say, I was wrong? I was wrong. I was wrong. I was wrong in 1985, when in a fight with the president of my seminary, as the newly elected president of black seminarians, because I was too cowardly to go to him and say what I should have said, I wrote from the book of Daniel, many, many tekel, you have been weighed in the balance and found wanting. I was a coward because I slipped the note under his door and without signing it, the way church people tend to do, the cowardly way of fighting, the anonymous note. And 6 months later, his wife died of cancer. 1 year later, my mother died unexpectedly. And I've always been ashamed of that note, that I had no right to use scripture, the Bible, to fight someone else. I had no right to wrench scripture out of context to prove my point. I had no right to use scripture to close conversation, to deny change, to disrupt what was going on. But like so many religious people, I used God to prove my self-righteousness, only for time to show me that it's not a matter whether he was wrong, whether he was wrong about the issue about black students and whether we should have had what we're demanding, and that was not the issue. At 61 now, that was not the issue. The issue was I was wrong for yanking scripture out of context, because I did not agree with his vision of change, which does not share my vision of change. And finally, Reuben. There are the Reubens. There is the Reuben in me. But I must close with one more story. That is the story in the book of Acts. I was not going to talk about it, but in memory of Margaret Parker, I want to mention in Acts. There in the book of Acts, that no one, and this is the wonderful thing about what is happening right now, that this nervousness about the church and the future of the church. It is our nervousness about the future of the North American church. It is not, there is the church, and then there is my church. There is the North American church is declining, but the church is not declining. That there are parts of the world, the global south, there are parts of the world where the church is growing. And could that be the laughter of God? Could that be the smile of God? That there in Africa and Latin and South America, that there in the other parts of the world, the global south, the underdeveloped world, the poor people, the dark continents, Christianity is on the rise. That must That must be hard to swallow for some of us. The notion that our privilege, the notion that our power, the notion that our heritage, the notion that our tradition, that God, there's a God who sits high and looks low. And can you share the church with the least of these, with the darkest of people, whose traditions will be so different? And so there in the book of Acts is the story of the voting in. I had to do this because as a Methodist myself and knowing about the voting process in the Methodist tradition, I just thought this, you know, at some point y'all gotta vote on something. So I thought I'd find this story. The story there is that it is time now to replace Judas. I won't read the text to you. It's time to replace Judas. I love this story. It's time to replace Judas. They are now in the room and they're waiting on the Holy Spirit. It has not yet come, but they're waiting on the Holy Spirit. And Jesus had told them, now go and wait for me. I'm going to send the Holy Spirit. And so they are there in the upper room. They are supposed to be praying. There's 120 of them. There are men and women, and they're supposed to be praying. They're supposed to be imploring God. They're supposed to be seeking the Spirit of God. And Peter had a good idea. He said, listen, I know y'all praying. I know the rest of y'all praying. But look at here, we need to replace Judas. And then he takes a text. Oh, my God, beware when they take a text before the vote. Beware when they call for a scripture before the vote. He said, listen, we need to replace Judas. You know Judas. He got what he deserved, and his guts were spilled, and he was one of the accursed. But let us now, because our numbers are only 11. Of course, I am paraphrasing, but I'm a black preacher, and we always paraphrase, and we like our sanctified imagination. But it's somewhere there in Acts 1. It's not quite the way I'm saying it, but it's the anointing has fallen, and so I'm going to elaborate here. And so it is now time to take the vote, and Peter gets up and Peter takes a text, and the text says that they began, there is the 11 who are there, and he says, let's cast lots. And he cast a lot, and he threw, of course it wasn't quite dice, but you know, in the black tradition, it sounds like they cast lots and they threw dice, and the vote fell on somebody by the name of Matthias. Never heard of him. But Peter does give the job description. He says it has to be somebody who had walked with Jesus, who has seen the resurrection, and who knew Jesus. And we had never heard of Matthias. I'm talking about change. It is time for a radical change. It is time for the new church that is on the horizon. It is now that the Spirit is moving across the people, and a new church, the ecclesia will be born. And here at this radical moment when the disciples could have done something radical and revolutionary that would have announced a new order, a new thing that is being born in the earth that will continue the ministry of Jesus, they cast lots, and the lot fell to someone we never heard of before. That is because there was only one person who was qualified for the job, but she didn't get the position. And her name was Mary Magdalene. Sometimes the best man for the job is a woman.
Right here.
If only Peter Nim had done right by Mary Magdalene, maybe it wouldn't have been so hard for me to become a woman in ministry. If only Peter Nim had seized carpe diem, seized the moment, and done something radically different and voted in and embraced and welcomed Mary Magdalene in as the missing apostle. Perhaps the story about parity and justice and power and gender and sexuality and love and marriage. Wouldn't have, 2,000 years later, it would not have been, if they just had the courage. Episcopal Church, do you have the courage? The courage to be different. The courage to make that radical embrace. The courage to see your future locked in with the global South. No, not just ecclesiastically. Not just in terms of your polity, but I mean in terms of your presence with black and brown people, with the other. Behold, I do a new thing in the earth. Do you not perceive it? Do you not see it? That even in 2015, at your Margaret Parker Lecture, in the midst of the business of the church, just a few miles down the road, presumably terrorism, rage and anger, murder and mayhem, and you sit here, what shall you do? Who will you embrace? Look around and see how much you all are alike. But in 2020, they say that in this country, you will be outnumbered by the very people who are angry, oppressed, yearning, searching. And if you are like me, you and I may be gone, but your children and your children's children and your children's children's children, what world are we leaving for them? What are you raising your grandson to be able to say to his black friends? How many children of other color have ever eaten at your table? And how many people of other color have you eaten at their table? How often have your children and your grandchildren seen you in settings of people who do not look like them? I hope I'm here in 2020, not for my sake, but for the sake of my own 22-year-old, who many years ago, and I know I must close, who many years ago, who's only 22, but who many years ago, when we sent her off to that great little private school there in Nashville, because I am grew up a colored girl from a colored schools there in Atlanta. I wanted her to have a better life, and I wanted her to have a better education, but I didn't want her to become integrated. I wanted to have her to have a better education, but I didn't want her to really become friends. I wanted her to have a better SAT and SAT score, but I didn't quite mean for her to bring Becky home. I didn't quite mean for her to ask me, can she go with me when we're going to Hawaii? Can she go also with us? Because she's an only child, so she wanted to bring somebody in. And all of my blackness and all of my southernness and all of my being my daddy's daughter and all of my racism and all of my history, this child, I had to make a decision whether my demons were going to become her demons. Mm. So Becky came. Because there is a God who sits high and looks low. And I never wanted my child to become who I have been over the years. And so I leave you with the great words of African slaves. Over my head, I hear music in the air. It's not the music that I understand, it's not the music that I sing. But I will clap and I will shout for the children's sake. For I believe that there is a God somewhere who sits high and looks low. And God says, I am with you even until the very ends of the earth. God bless you.
Amen.